Good rising, brethren.
This is Big Judah coming to you guys from California. Before I begin, give all praise to the Most High, Yahweh. Acknowledgement to the Earthly Mother, who was wisdom, who was the Holy Spirit. Acknowledgement to Yahweh Shai. I pray that the Most High blesses this lesson this evening, gives more knowledge and understanding of the events of the past in order to understand events that are currently happening on the earth. So we get a much better understanding of the things that are soon to come on the earth. Most High has instructed me to pretty much make a blitzkrieg of videos. And that's what I plan to do. Bringing out a whole lot of this information in a rapid pace. So if you don't get notifications, I would suggest just coming back and just checking the channel periodically over the course of the day to find more videos, more information coming out, because that's the times that we are in right now. As you sit there and I'm looking at social media, I'm looking at these people out partying as everything around them is crumbling, you see how we are in the days of Noah. How, you know, as everything is falling apart around these people, instead of actually trying to preserve themselves, they just throw themselves head first into whatever's to come, into the destruction. They could care less about trying to preserve themselves, preserve their lives. You know, a lot of this stuff that's happening right now with the plague is just, it's really showing us people's spirits. Doesn't matter really if it's real or fake. What is real is us being able to see the spirits of people. And they will do anything to enjoy, you know, their blessing. And they will go so far as to hide our history, ignore our history. And see, there's two things going on. The Most High is revealing these Gentiles and, you know, and their spirits, even our people. That have, you know, taken the bag. He's revealing their spirits. All the while, underneath, like underground right now, the Most High is revealing our true history to us. He's showing us exactly where it was that we came from. He's showing how he established the earth. He's showing how he established, these ley lines and the setup of the earth. He's showing now that there's a connection between the Americas and our people being over here in the Americas as well over in Europe. And how they've hidden absolutely everything. So let me go ahead and continue. Let's get in this real quick. Ancient history deception. Okay. British European history. Because the academia has withdrawn. I would suggest getting this book right now. It's kind of like a pamphlet. There should be plenty of them. But who knows? So once you actually make the connection, see, they'll let you know that there's some things wrong with history, but they won't make that connection with why they're hiding history. Okay? This was sent to me, this book here. Someone sent me an email, told me I needed to get this book. I purchased it right away, got it, and it starts to actually fill in many of the gaps with these other more expensive books. You know, I said you start to be able to put the puzzle pieces together. And this book is huge. I'm going to share a little bit of it right now. We're going to get into this, and we're going to connect it with other books as well. So let's go. Thank you. Thank you again for the member who sent me this, the subscriber who sent me this. I said, this is huge, and I want to definitely say thank you for sending this to me. I appreciate it. The Nation is definitely going to be is going to appreciate it as well. Now, I shared a video last night about the that guy unearthed who goes around and, you know, investigates things, is always puts his opinion in everything. And he was talking about how he just happened to be in Scotland on vacation. And he was checking out the serpent mound that was there. Then he made a connection with the one that was in Ohio and a serpent mound that was there. Then he went to Iowa and he talked to a guy there who made another, you know, another connection. And you need to watch that, because when you know what to look for, now these guys, like I said, we got them. We got them, because as soon as they start trying to talk about prehistoric history, they started putting pictures of white people. They started talking about, you know, the Scottish people, the Druids and whatever else coming over. And they showed a white woman with a cape dancing around. It showed a white men, white people, you know, as they were the ones that were from prehistory, prehistoric times. See, they always put in their opinions and they're always trying to drill that thing about white people being everywhere, when they know that's not true. We've already shown you plenty of books that talked about how it was, you know, the stories, they're folk tales, and it was always like about tall, black, supposedly so-called black men. But we're going to get into that in a little bit. Okay? Maybe not on this video, but on a couple more to come. Okay? So right now, we're going to talk about the languages. And a sister actually hit me up and told me that the Gaelic languages, okay, the Gaelic language is actually Hebrew. She told me to make sure I kind of research that. Well, this book right here just confirmed what it was she already told me. But like I said, that's what happens when you're a community and you work together. And you bring this information together as a community. Check this out right here. Irish Gaelic language is Phoenician. And we know that Phoenician is Hebrew. As we have seen from the academic maps portraying trade routes of the Phoenicians, academia denies an association between Ireland and Britain with our Phoenician friends, as we have seen. See map 31. Okay, on page 31. We'll do that again later on. If you still doubt the connection, please consider that in about 200 BC, a Roman playwright, Titus Macius Plautus, wrote a play called Penelus, into which he included a Phoenician as one character in the play. From this play, please see the Phoenician words below and then compare it to the Irish Gaelic words. Remember that Phoenician and Hebrew were Canaanite languages, i.e. essentially the same. So again, remember the Phoenician and Hebrew were Canaanite languages, essentially the same. So you got the Phoenician right there. Take a look at it. Phoenician of Plautus. Okay, Phoenician 200 BC. Take a look at it right there. I'm not even going to try to read it right there, but you can check it out right there, okay? And then early Irish Celtic. So you start taking a look at that one. Irish Gaelic in Ireland in modern times. And you start looking at them, and it's very, very similar. Almost exactly the same. Few words here and there, a little changed, a little bit more information, a couple more words. But as you can see, it's almost the same, just about. But see, they've been trying to hide our languages this whole time, especially the, as they like to call them, prehistoric languages. We don't know who these people are. We don't know anything about them. See, they just lie. They don't want to know. They don't want to admit it, that these were our people that were there thousands of years before they got there. All these great things that were built before they got there, we did that. Castles, we built that. Oh, these mounds that are, you know, aligned to the stars. You know, that one in that Unearthed show was great because it showed how that serpent in Ireland or Scotland was like all set up with archaeoastronomy, you know, and it's like they just kind of downplay it. Yeah, a lot of these places are set up, you know, aligned to the stars. It's not like that's like some no great feat. Like that wasn't no big deal. Like they just, you know, they set up this that serpent, you know, with the two peaks of the mountains that were off in the distance in order to, you know, work with the solstices and the equinoxes. I mean, absolutely amazing the way they were setting all these things up. And how actually you can, with the one in Ohio, you can actually get a much better view of it and understanding of it when you actually are flying or over the top of it. But see, they've been trying so hard to make it seem as if, you know, the people, the prehistoric people had, you know, no technology, you know, but these people were way more advanced than they've let on. And now they've been, you know, they're actually Mos Eisley exposing them now. So let's continue. Says, please understand that standardization of spelling is a rather modern concept. So in particular, notice that it is the sounds or phonetics, okay, are identical. There we go. It says, in 1772, General Charles Valency, a leading Irish scholar, published his famous work, Essay on the Antiquity of the Irish Language, being a collation of the Irish with the Punic Hebrew language. That's a title for you right there. All right. He says, in his opening remarks, he states, on a collation of the Irish with the Celtic, Punic, Phoenician, and Hebrew languages, the strongest affinity, nay, a perfect identity in very many words will appear. So these languages are the same. Many of the words are the same. But see, this is all before the Indo-Europeans came. So they wanted to come in later on and change things up. It says, if you are still not convinced of this direct historical connection, there is more evidence that supports the Phoenician, Hebrew, Israelite people going to Ireland, colonizing, and therefore initiating a descendancy through to today. So they're, like I said, these guys were way before. And actually, in the story, in the video of Unearth that I shared with you guys, the guy was kind of like talking about, what was he talking about here this time? I mean, there was so much information. Oh, they were saying that that Ireland and England were being populated by people who were coming from Europe. They were just, you know, people that were just coming in and bringing their pagan beliefs over there. You know, it's always got to be a pagan, right? Any beliefs that's not theirs, there's always something wrong with it. It's a pagan, you know, same old thing. But they were saying that there weren't people already over there on those islands, but it was just, they were being populated by people. And then, of course, they push white people coming over to Ireland, right? And England, Britain, and populating the places. But this is telling you something different. This is telling you something right here. It says Phoenician, Hebrew, Israelite people going to Ireland, colonizing, and therefore initiating a descendancy through to today. Again, I got to read that again. There is more evidence that supports the Phoenician, Hebrew, Israelite people going to Ireland, colonizing, and therefore initiating a descendancy through to today. So now you're understanding more so why they hid Acts 29. Paul going to his people into these lands, because they'd already been there thousands of years before the Indo-Europeans came. They want to make it seem as if they were there the whole time. So they're going to be like, oh, no. Leave that Acts 29 out, because we don't want them knowing that his people were also scattered to Britain and to Ireland. They wanted to make sure that everybody thought that those were their lands originally. So therefore, when we start getting into all these different, effigies, and all these different stoneworks and, you know, and castles, they wanted to take credit for all of that. But the Most High is now bringing that information back to his people. So if you can show now that there's a descendancy that was already there before the Indo-Europeans came, now all those things that were built over there, they can't take credit for anymore. It says, as you can see on the map of Spain, there was a town called Brigantium, Coruña today. It was an ancient port and has the world's oldest lighthouse. Although credited to the Romans, again, here they come in later, taking credit, says it was built upon the foundations laid by the early Phoenicians. So they want to come in and take credit, but this is something that was built by the early Phoenicians. Of course, it should be logical, even to academia, that a port, okay, should have existed, you know, to provision ships traveling west to the British Isles or Ireland from the continent. So see, they wanted to make sure they're going to take credit for everything. But it would make sense. They would have a port, you know, to get resupplied. It says, a large statue has prominence at the base of the lighthouse. This is King Brohagam, who the Irish claim as the ancestors. Okay? Who the Irish claim as an ancestor, as do the Spanish. So they just come in, just trying to take credit for absolutely everything. Mr. Me Too again, right? It says, in contradiction to what we have seen elsewhere in Wiki Academia, do acknowledge the lighthouse on the below wiki, okay? It says, according to legend, King Breogan constructed a massive tower that his sons could see Ireland from there. It is a fact that sea routes between Galicia and Ireland were established in prehistoric times. Again, established before they even got over here. And strengthened after the 6th century BC. The lighthouse was reconstructed by the ancient Phoenicians before the Romans. So, of course, academia have relegated King Breogan to legend. See, they move everything down to legend and folklore when they don't want to deal with it. Then they want to, you know, they don't want to actually have to explain these things. So now it's just a legend, okay? In the center of the Spanish capital city, Madrid, there is a park called Parque de Breogan, okay? Honoring what the Spanish describe as their founding Celtic king. Like I said, it's just funny now for them to sit here and try to hide all this information. And they said the Most High is now exposing them. And it's funny how the Spanish describe as their founding Celtic king. Clearly, the ancestors of the people of today were wrong about their ancestors. Exactly. But they want to quickly just come in and take over. You know, there's a whole lot of facts around that are going to show something totally different. Now, this right here is from the Black Celts book. Okay. I want to read this part real quick right here about how they tried to, what they've been trying to do with the languages and how they've done it worldwide. It says, the Irish assimilated the local population of Ireland gradually over the course of centuries. So we know that they're talking about the Indo-Europeans trying to assimilate the Aborigines, the original population. And they've done the same thing over here. Listen. Okay, they did not impose their language on the Aborigines, but rather induced them to adopt Irish. So you got to learn that new language. Okay, they didn't force them. Okay. So such language change is invariably preceded by a period of bilingualism, where the native speaks both his language, but also learns that of the intruder. Yeah, I'm just showing you right here, the Irish are the intruders. See, they're forcing their languages on us shows you who the intruder is. Just like they did here with English, and they tried to force us not to speak our native languages. They did that. Spanish, they did that. They've done it all with French. They've done that. Everywhere they go, they've imposed their intruder languages, you know, on our people. So such language change is invariably preceded by a period of bilingualism, where the native speaks both his own language, but also learns that of the intruder. Consequently, in order to resolve the problem of the Irish origins, it is necessary not only to demonstrate intrusion, but also to explain the reason of bilingualism. Yeah, why is there, if you guys were already here, why is there a need for bilingualism? Wouldn't we always speak, if you were the original people, why would you bring a new language into the country? Because you're not the original people. So therefore now you got to force your language on everyone else. Which proves again that you were not there thousands of years ago, because you would be no need for you to have to force a new language on anyone. So now keep going down. No attempt was made at this conference to tackle the question of what language was spoken by original population of Ireland. Exactly. Why didn't they talk about the original languages? Because then they'll realize that these original languages, okay, have roots. And they don't want to talk about where those roots come from. Because they don't want you to realize who the real people are. Who were the original people that were there. Because then you have to attribute the things that were built there to those people as well. So they just ignore the fact that there were people here speaking a certain language, you know, and then so they can go to Stonehenge and say, well, we don't know who built this. We don't know who built this. We don't know who was responsible. We weren't here, but we don't know who it was. Yes, you do. So again, no attempt was made at this conference to tackle the question of what language was spoken by original population of Ireland. Old Irish deviates from the Indo-European model due to the influence of Erythraic. Not only did the original population learn to speak Irish in the Erythraic manner, but they also retained many Erythraic words which have now passed into Irish. The same is true for the Welsh. No mention was made of the Afallo substratum in Ireland. Since Northwest Africa has so much in common with Ireland, okay, one would have expected at least one speaker to have approached the topic. They know what not to talk about. Just like in church, they know not to talk about Deuteronomy 28. They know not to talk about the curses. So if you want to know what's really going on and what they're hiding, look at what they don't talk about, what they won't acknowledge. So we showed you how, you know, the older languages went, you know, like with Hebrew. And now you got this one where they were trying to make the natives learn a new language, but they wouldn't talk about the original languages because they're hiding that information. Now, I little side note before I finish. I got an email from YouTube and they were talking about how, you know, since it's their platform, they can put ads on any video they want. I think that's how I understood it. So if you happen to start seeing ads or whatever else on the videos, it's not me monetizing the videos. It's just YouTube saying they can do whatever they want on their platform. And if they choose to put ads on, that's what they're going to do. So I just wanted to let you guys know that. Okay. Be on the lookout for more videos later on. Here we go, family. We're going to get even more into this truth and get more information. If you have anything else to add, please go ahead and get in the comment section and get that in there as well. Do what you guys do, family. All praise is to the Most High, Yahweh. Acknowledgement to the Earthly Mother. Who is wisdom? Who is the Holy Spirit? Acknowledge Yahweh Shai. Shalom.